Hi, thanks so much for tuning in. You're watching BQ Prime. My name is Alex Matthew. We've got a great conversation lined up for you. The recent Hindenburg episode has raised or reignited conversations and debates here in India about the regulatory framework that governs short selling. And a lot has been said so far, but my guest today and quite a few of the authors that have co-written a piece on short selling argue that there is a place for short selling in India. And in fact, short selling activism helps to improve the marketplace. I'm going to ask him why. Joining me now is Ajay Shah, the co-founder of XKDR Forum. Thanks so much, Ajay, for taking the time. And I'm referring to an article that you have co-written with KP Krishnan, Renuka Sane, Anjali Sharma, Harshvardhan, and Bhargavi Zaveri Shah. We're going to be putting this on the website as well. But right off the bat, you've mentioned that the regulatory framework in India that governs short selling and the process of short selling in India is different from other markets in the world. Could you explain how that is?
Elsewhere in the world, the word short selling is generally used to convey the following idea, that a person will borrow shares through a formal mechanism and sell them in the hope that the price is going to go down. Okay, so the steps are, I believe a price is going to go down. I borrow the shares today. I sell them. Then if I'm right, the price does indeed go down. Some days later, I buy back the shares from the market and I made a profit because I sold at 100 and I bought it back at 90. And that is how I make money from a speculative forecast that a price is going to go down. Okay, now in India, we really don't have this kind of capability. There is practically no formal mechanism whereby people are able to borrow and lend shares to each other. So there was the beginnings of setting this up at NSE in about 2010, 2011. But I don't think it ever got the level of focus that was required to make it work. And bottom line is that realistically, there is no mechanism to borrow shares in any significant quantity in India. Very well. Is there any other method through which I can express a negative view on the market? You can short sell the stock futures. You could take positions using the options. For example, if you believe that a price is going to go down, you could buy put options. Here, it runs into the problem of the position limits. The position limits in India have been set at very small levels. So the example we show in the article is that the present value of the position limit for the Infosys futures is rupees 3 crore. Okay, so now rupees 3 crore of a short position, suppose you come out to be correct, and there's a 10% drop in the price, it's a profit of 30 lakh rupees. It's very nice for a retail investor, but really it is not material for a professional. So no significant systematic investment organization would be able to go after it. So for these reasons, for all practical purposes, there is no meaningful role of short selling in the Indian market today.
And it's not lucrative. So as a result of which this function moves overseas, how does that work?
Elsewhere in the world, short selling is well established. There are mechanisms for borrowing shares. Okay, I don't know the exact number, but I believe that the position limits on the Indian derivatives trading on exchanges abroad are better as compared to what you see here. And of course, on the OTC market, there are no restrictions. So I think the broad capability of the global financial system, when it is applied to Indian securities, is able to do the things that are very normally done in the global financial system, but which are not feasible in India. So, you know, I assume that somebody like Hindenburg must have found an ability to either borrow the bonds of Adani Group entities or shares of Adani Group entities and manage to achieve a substantial position, which would justify the costs involved in all the activities that they undertook.
So, at the core of it, and this is my reading of it, Ajay, correct me if I'm wrong, there seems to be a bit of a bias against short selling and against the manner in which it is done, because invariably it relates to the highlighting of negative information about a company that that results in the share going down. But that is market function at the end of the day. Do you think that there is a bias against short selling in India?
So yes, in India today, you and I can borrow money and buy shares, but we can't borrow shares and sell them. So there is an asymmetry that the Indian financial ecosystem is systematically supportive of a speculative buyer and is systematically unfriendly towards a speculative seller. So to that extent, I think that there is a lack of symmetry between longs and shorts in India.
Now, you've also talked about the distinction between short selling and market abuse and the importance of the regulatory framework focusing on that distinction. But how does a regulator identify instances of market abuse?
So the first point that I would like to make is that a speculator who is optimistic and will borrow money and buy shares, or a speculator who is pessimistic and will borrow shares and sell them. Okay, these are both perfectly normal, healthy, useful activities on the market. Where you cross the line into malfeasance is the phrase market abuse. Lots of the drafting of current laws in India is not very well done. So these things are not as clear in India today as they need to be. But for example, the draft of the Indian Financial Code that was done by FSLRC is crystal clear on these subjects. And market abuse is not okay, and we need a regulatory machinery to go after market abuse. Whereas having speculative views on the market, whether positive or negative, is perfectly normal. So what is market abuse? Market abuse comes in two kinds. There is the so-called market-based abuse, where a person has market power and significant financial clout through which they are able to move the price of a share on the market. Okay, so it's just like it's market power brought into the world of financial markets. If I'm the dominant player in the two-wheeler market and I use my market power to create an exaggerated price for two-wheelers, that would be called market power. And we would want machinery such as the Competition Commission of India to enforce against that. That same concept applies in the world of securities. That if I'm doing trades and positions that are very large as compared with the normal activities of the market, then that is called market-based abuse. And the other category is information-based abuse, where generally it refers to the regulated information release of firms being distorted in ways that create false information in the eyes of the users of the information. So a firm is putting out an accounting statement and they put out false information in the accounting statement, and that misleads people in the market and that creates a wrong price. So all this fits under the rubric of what is called market abuse. So what we argue in the article is that market abuse is a bad thing and we need a regulatory apparatus to enforce against market abuse, but we should not conflate speculative buying or speculative selling with market abuse. Market abuse is a special case of these activities. It is not true that all speculation is equal to all market abuse.
What is the benefit of short selling? And in an ideal scenario, as you see it and as your co-authors see it, how would short selling help to improve a marketplace like India?
The purpose of a financial market is to discover the fair price, and this has enormous consequences for society. It is sometimes said that Wall Street tells Main Street what to do. So the prices that are discovered on the financial market system have enormous consequences for inducing the entire resource allocation of the country. So the purpose of the financial markets system is to get the right price, to find the right price. And that comes out of a process of an argument between optimists and pessimists. which is conducted on the market. So some people believe that 100 rupees is too low for this price. Some people believe that 100 rupees is too high for this price, and they come and trade with each other. And the outcome of that trading process in an open, fair, free market is roughly correct, is a good description of all the knowledge and all the analysis coming out at a point in time. So the value of short selling is that when a price becomes too high, then there is a self-correcting market force through which the price comes back to reality. And you need both in the market. You need optimists and you need pessimists. If only one side is proscribed or selectively switched off, then it does not give you correct outcomes in terms of the price discovery.
Okay. Now, moving back to the Indian regulatory framework, and you've described what works and what doesn't in India and the ways in which short selling can take place. The mechanism of the securities lending and borrowing, or rather the SLBM or securities lending and borrowing mechanism, is what facilitates short selling, by my understanding, Ajay.
Yes.
To broad base this, and seemingly it hasn't worked to make this a large part of our markets. So how does the Indian regulatory framework change in order to facilitate more short selling and short selling in the right manner?
The SLBM is surrounded by an intricate set of rules, as is everything about the Indian financial system. The rules are very detailed and by and large extremely restrictive. So this is a recurring theme that we have seen for many years in Indian finance, that an array of rules reduce the freedom of the participants in the market, and this can't be done and that can't be done and this can't be done and that can't be done. So the quantitative limits that are put on the size of an activity and the list of restrictions through which the activity is prevented has become large and onerous. And in order to make the SLBM work, what will be needed is a careful review of those rules. And I also want to make a larger comment in that the appropriate way in which these things should work is that financial market participants should devise the appropriate market design. And in India, all too often, we find that it is SEBI that designs everything. So SEBI controls everything. SEBI writes down all the rules and defines every aspect of the trading process in every detail. And I think this is not wise, because officials in a regulator are not well-incentivized individuals who wish to make the market mechanism work. And this is a problem showing up all across the place. For example, I just talked about the position limit for Infosys stock futures being rupees 3 crore. That's a small number. It's really a very poorly chosen number, but it has come out of the present regulation making process that is led by SEBI. So overall, what I feel is that there needs to be a better working of the rulemaking process in SEBI, and also a significant retreat by the Indian state in the questions about how these trading mechanisms are structured. These things should come out of private people, not out of governments.
Okay. And finally, on the ecosystem, do you think that a change in regulation would bring out also a change in the ecosystem? Because you need entities to lend security as well, right? And that needs to also be a lucrative process for somebody to enter the fray.
Yeah, it's actually fairly easy to solve that problem. So think about it. Let's go to an institutional owner of shares, and the shares are slumbering in the depository. Actually, you're paying a little bit of money to the equivalent of a custodian or the depository participant for safekeeping of your shares. Now, imagine if there was a mechanism through which there was zero risk, so there's no credit risk at all, and I'm able to lend my shares, and I'm able to get 2 basis points annualized for it. Okay, this is better than zero. So at very low interest rates, institutional investors will come out and lend essentially infinite amounts of shares, as long as the mechanism is up and running. And what has happened in India is that basic mechanism never got to working properly.
I think we've had a quite comprehensive conversation, Ajay, on this topic, and I'm sure that there will, of course, be a lot of debate on our platform and otherwise. Thank you so much for taking the time. Always a pleasure speaking with you.
Thanks, Alex.
Viewers, do stay tuned. Lots more coming up over the course of the day. Remember, you can read all of the details of the article that was co-written, as I said, by Ajay Shah on the website bqprime.com. Do stay tuned.